You're standing, Kevin. That means you got to get your groove on.
More than just chair dancing for the hymn. Nice. That's a classic.
Good morning.
Hello.
Hello. How is everybody?
Doing well. Doing very well. Oh, look at that mug that Kevin has.
Ooh.
What a great mug. Plus, he's got a ring light. We can see that.
We love the ring light reflection. Oh, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody show your reflections.
Everybody works.
Ring light.
Everybody upgraded during the COVID.
That's right.
That's awesome. That would have been a great screenshot. Can you grab a screenshot of that? Show your ring lights.
Oh, yeah. Somebody grab us a screenshot of the ring lights. There we go.
Grab a screenshot. There you go.
Okay, now go.
Oh, we got it.
Oh, Joe's chiming in that her mug is her idiotic mug is her everyday work coffee mug, and that's awesome. Oh, Kristen broke hers the first time she used it. Well, we'll have to solve that problem.
Yeah,
we'll get you hooked up.
Yeah, Joe, it's this is my everyday coffee cup, and I started this, and I was reminded I have the wrong cup.
Not that we make people use the right cup, but we're just letting people know that there is wrong coffee mugs, and then there's the right coffee mug.
Right.
Very cool. Good morning, everybody in the chat. Some weather reports going around here in Eastern Ontario. It started as a rainy day. Now it's sunny, and it's going to be rainy again. Later, we're getting all the weathers today.
Getting all the weathers.
Yep. All the summery weathers anyway. So. Yeah, we have Kevin with us again, Kevin Thorn.
Sorry.
And we're doing a little bit of an extension of what we've talked about with Kevin a few different times. But for the gang who haven't been with us before, Kevin, let's do the 30-second introduce yourself, and then we'll go from there.
I am Kevin, probably the oldest living geek. let's see. I ran away from home and joined the Army. Ended up being good at it, so I retired. Then I went to corporate America, ended up in IT. By circumstances, like most of us, ended up in the training department, spent another decade learning all that, self-taught, and then I quit and started my own company. So that's what I do. E-learning, instructional design, illustration, art, comics, animation, just jack of all trades, master of none.
And you know what, Kevin? It's always better to be the oldest living geek than the oldest non-living geek, I would say.
There's that, right?
You know, on the plus side.
But I have fun. As long as I'm not bored, I'll keep doing it.
Exactly.
Maybe when I get bored, I'll go do something else.
You don't strike me as somebody that gets bored too easily.
Yeah, no. I don't know. There's always something to keep my... You know, if it's not making something, I'm playing, you know, so...
Mm-hmm. It's not a bad life, is it?
I'm grateful and very fortunate. So yes,
for sure, for sure. So on past episodes, you've given us a tour of the visual alphabet, so we can understand how anybody who doesn't know how to draw could actually draw things.
Right.
Say perhaps a storyboarding. Last time around, we were looking at colorization or pictorialization, I guess, of photographs. We were working through on that. Yep. We've done a couple of other things in the meantime, you know, comic related things, etc., on different episodes. And this week we're talking about moving from still images to stop motion animation with little tricks and stuff. I guess using your mobile device.
Yeah. So I mean, there's a lot of ways. I think probably the interesting thing is. There's a lot of video production. You know, video has been kind of on an upswing the last couple of years. And video, just think about our own lives and our own experiences when we're scrolling through social media. We tend to stop and watch a video before we look or read about a still image. So video, there's some kind of a pull to video. And then we can get into the whole the science behind micro videos and all that. That's not what we're here about. It's about the production value. And then we have... these ideas that we get inspired to build video for our training or e-learning or whatever output that we're looking at. The challenge a lot of time is time and money production, you know, setting up a live action stage, you know, getting on set and all the gear, the lighting, the equipment. And it's a huge production to put in a live action video. All of that same planning. So if you think about, I got to make a video and you still do the storyboarding, you still do the design, you still do the scripting. All of that's on the front end. Stop motion animation is just another output of video. It's all it is. Okay. So when you get to the point where I've got a script, I've got a plan, I've got an idea, I've got actors, and here's where I want the set to be, and then I want to change the scenes over to this set, and you've got all that planned out, then it's like, okay, now how are we going to produce it? So it goes back to that, and you've heard me get on my chair before about separating design from development. There are two different disciplines. If what we choose a developer, our output is endless. Now, obviously, we kind of have some sort of an idea of how we're going to output it while we're designing. I mean, I get that. But in general, if I design a video, you could go make a live action video or a stop motion animation with the same script and the same plan. Mm-hmm. That's the idea. That's how simple it really is. Now, obviously, we don't have time to get into the details of the mechanics of all that. But stop motion animation is low fidelity. It's low cost. You can put one together really quickly just to get the concept. And it's not about, you know, these full production videos, you know, that you see. And I was just looking for something around my studio that I failed to grab. And I don't see him. He's going to pop up here somewhere. So anyway, what I got to share today, I've got gear. The important thing about stop motion animation, just like any set, is lighting, your ring light. Lighting, and then your camera, obviously a smartphone or an iPad, and you can use a DSLR. So your hardware, and then all your tripods and setups like that. But then all of the little, making a stop motion animation, I guess one of the big things, how many have seen a Lego stop motion animation video? Mm-hmm. They're dime a dozen out there, and they're fun to watch. So you can use Lego, but sometimes that gets saturated with, depending on the story, because you really got to have a good story with that. And because they're so small, you really got to take a lot of frames in order to make that work. But you can do them with construction paper, cardboard, household objects, clay. You know, you can use live outdoor settings and then use a combination of different characters that you know, grab around your kid's toy room. So it doesn't matter what objects you use. Objects are what's being moved through, and those are going to represent the characters or the scene or the setting. Everything else is just imagination at that point. So with that, I'm going to stop and ask questions. And real quick, I've got a camera here, but I can see you all. So I have to turn to look at the chat this way. So
totally okay. Do what you need.
So I can't see the chat looking at you. So I need to look at the chat now to see if there's any questions, but.
It's okay. We can look at your nugget head hat and it's all good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't seen any questions in the chat so far. Lots of comments.
All right. Let me turn my camera down here. We're going to look at some of the lighting and some of the hardware. Hang on here. I'm going to flip my camera down. Y'all see that? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thanks. So first up, you're good. No, I got a black shirt on. This is not helping. So let me pull that away. There we go. So this is your standard sort of gorilla grip kind of tripod. And these work really great because especially if you're outdoors, you know, you can wrap this around a pole. You can do upside down angles, get different angles with them. So these are really handy. I think just about everybody's got one. If not, a tabletop, just a simple tabletop tripod works well. I would recommend getting some kind of a GorillaPod. Now that's a brand name. I know they're not all like that, but one of these flexible leg ones where you can, you know, bend it around things. And they're easy to pack. You can pack this and your smartphone and you're done. Now this is my travel tripod. And then I've got this thing, which is the Glyph from Studio Neat. And it is all it is spring loaded.
Okay.
Right. So you take your phone.
And is that a cam on the back then to lock it in?
Yeah. And then it's got a little cam lever.
Okay.
So it's now in there. But then you put you put your little standard quarter inch extensions on both, and it's got one on the top, one on the bottom, and one on the side right here. So you can put this on your tripod, then put a light. So here's a little Manfrotto LED light. Set that one on top. And then if you do need a microphone, you can mount a microphone to the bottom. So you can mount a microphone, a light, and your camera all on this little thing, put it on top of your, and set a tripod up, and you're ready to go. Easy peasy. And these things, this was a Kickstarter early on, like around iPhone 4 or 5. This is the second design updated so it can accommodate some of the bigger phones that started coming out. And I think it's about $30, and it's the best one that I've seen. A bunch of them. And I like this one the best. And it's compact, put it in your pocket. So that right there is all you need to get started. You got to have your, probably one of the most important things, let me get my dad face down here. One of the most important things is stop motion animation, lighting, and when you hit the shutter, every time you touch the shutter, your camera is going to move. So you need to have it as stable as possible. Otherwise, you're going to start seeing these jumps in your film. So a good tripod and a good, and then
also you can also light is, if you happen to have an iWatch, you can trigger your your shutter from your iWatch.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Yeah, so well, it depends. If you're just using the cameras, if you're just using the camera shutter, camera app, then yeah, you can use your iWatch as a shutter. But then you've got post-production, because then you have to pull all of those frames out.
Yeah.
And you're talking 300, 400, 500 frames.
That's right. So right? you're gonna tell us the special app to use.
That's right. Anybody remember this? Can you see that?
Oh, the flip phone. Oh my gosh. I just found one in a box.
The flip camera. Well, way back in the day. So what, about 15 years ago?
Yeah, long time ago.
Was it? Yeah, that's early 2000s, I think. No, it was about 2010. About 10 years ago. Anyway, this little tripod came with it. And it's great because it angles. And if you want to do a close-up of, you want to do a close-up. So you do something like that where you angle it down, put your glyph on like this, and then put that on. And you see how the angles, and it comes right down so you can get a close-up. I'm trying to turn it this way. You see how it's angled down? Mm-hmm. So this is a great tripod where it sits low to the ground. So if you're using things like small things like Lego minifigures and things like that, and you want to move them, real slowly across in front of the camera. So it's all about, it's all about angle, camera angles, and setup and scene, and it make it look like you're outdoors. But you can do this, and you can get down real close to like the grass in your yard and have a little minifigure like scooting through the grass like he's exploring the jungle. Close-up shot, and you've got a stage about the size of a square foot, and that's your production, and that's it, and you can come out with a cool little video. I don't have the other setup here, but it's on the other side of the room and another setup over there, but those clip-on boom lights that you just clip on your table and it's got a little boom and then well, that boom works really well with this as well. So you just rig up another adjustment, put that on the end of the boom, and then now you have your camera directly facing down flat surface. And then that way you can do paper.
Yeah.
Paper cutout kind of a deal. Like
I was just going to say, I think everybody, there's different types of this kind of stop motion animation that's really fun to do. And it just doesn't always have to be a character or a person moving a little bit at a time. You can do letters and other objects and make it
any household objects. And it's just how you, so if you wanted to practice something, let me see, let me grab here. I've got some other stuff, but like say you have a piece of jute rope. So you can do something where you've got the rope here, you take a picture, you move the rope, and it's like you make the rope look like it's the character. This can be the character, right? So you can do, that's the great thing about stop motion animation, because there's no rules. you break every rule known, and it's just about the most important thing is the lighting and the camera angle. So if you want to, yeah, you need a straight down angle, you need this kind of an angle. Do you need an angle this way? You know, depending. And then you can get really fun where you start moving the camera in an arc, you know, so you can like zoom and pan at the same time, you know, like a rig like that. And I got a rig here. I'll show you in a minute. I don't know. I just broke my flip camera.
Oh, no.
Well, that thing's been like with me forever.
What?
What's the warranty on that?
Yeah, well, I don't know, but I just broke it.
Depends on who bought flip, I guess.
Yeah. It's all right. Super glue. They sell it to anybody. Okay.
So what? Are we gonna do the app?
Or just a little. Huh?
Ooh, that,
I'm sorry.
What app are we going to be talking about today?
We'll get to that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We're still on hardware.
Bring the gun.
Then we'll get the software.
Okay.
It's just a little suction. It's a magnet. So depending on your case, a lot of the newer phones have built-in magnets, you know, in them. But you just lay it on there. Mm. And again, it's close. Now, but if you need to put it up higher on something and then put it like this, you still get an angle. And you can get these things at Office Depot. They're usually in the impulse aisle for like $5-$10, right? Lighting, I already showed you the, wait a minute, here's another one. This is for an iPad. And when we get to software and you're talking about remote shutter, there's an app that it's pretty popular across all stop motion. And there's two apps, one's a remote shutter and one's the actual camera. And then use the iPad and the iPhone. One becomes a shutter, one becomes the camera.
Okay.
So I use the iPhone because it's got a better camera. So I'll use that as the camera. Plus it's smaller and I can do different things with it. And then I use the iPad as the shutter because I can see the screen. I can do the onion skinning and I can hit the iPad and this doesn't never get touched. So it doesn't shake. And I'll show you how that's all set up here in a minute when we get to that point. But if you're doing a multi-device, then you need an iPad holder as well. And this, again, this is a little iPow is the brand. It came with a selfie stick, I think. I don't know. Mm. But it's designed to hold just about any size. So it's just plastic. You put your iPad in there, crank it down, and it's got the standard quarter inch to put on a tripod. The only thing with this one is it doesn't rotate. So it's always going to be, right, you know, like this. So unless you have to have a swivel on your tripod to kind of swivel it back a little bit. Otherwise, it's always going to be straight up. Then this one I just recently got, and I really like it. I don't know about the spring. It's a real tight spring, and it barely gets over my iPhone 7. iPhone 7 with the case. I said this is 11. I just got this one.
Yeah.
So it's a real tight fit. That's the maximum stretch on that. But what I like about this one is it's got this metal ball. Can you see?
Right, it's got a ball joint, eh? Yeah.
Yeah, it's got a ball joint on it and a standard quarter inch on the bottom. Yeah, same thing, Brent. Yeah, just your same kind of extension thing. But this one's really great because it's got the ball. So you can go horizontal or vertical and you can spin it. This is pretty versatile one right here.
Mm-hmm.
And
ball joints are really useful for a lot of photography stuff.
And because it's the standard quarter inch here and here on the actual holder, it comes off. So if you want to put something else on that stand, so
yep,
that's a pretty versatile little. And this is by a company called Bower, B-O-W-E-R. And Bower, this came with my ring light setup, and I'm gonna see if I can swing that around here a little bit so you can see this, because I think you'll be really impressed with this thing. Hang on. I'm impressed with it. Turn off the light real quick. So there's the ring light, but can you see this right here? Let me see if I can swing it around here a little bit without breaking everything. Oh, the lighting's not, there we go. So that's another spring loaded.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a thumb screw right here that then rotates, and it's got a ball pivot on it as well.
Okay.
So it sits straight up. So you can bring this down, angle your light down, angle your camera down, and you've got the tripod and the camera mount and the light all built into a tabletop tripod all at the same time. And it, it's got all kinds of brightnesses, LED, warm, cool filters on it, everything. The tripod, the mounts, and this thing, I was looking for a USB drive at Walmart, and it was on the end cap, and it was a box, B-O-W-E-R, and it had the, you know, it's called a podcast selfie stand. I don't, can't remember how they marketed it, but I looked at it, and the first thing I thought, oh, that's the perfect height for stop motion, and it comes with it, right? $20. Like the light with all kinds of different filters and adjustments, two brackets for your iPhone. You can't go wrong for $20.
No kidding.
And then lastly, the one I'll be using is the suction cup iPad, kind of the same thing, but it's built in with a very standard GoPro-ish kind of look, suction cup kind of thing, where you, you know, you just press it down and then it isn't going anywhere. Right. Lastly, on the hardware store, wait, we got quite a few more things to share. Any questions so far? This is another really favorite. This is a USB ring light. And it's got different color modes, you know, the blue, the oranges, and different things. But it's USB. So you just charge it. And once it's charged, then you just clip it on wherever you need, put the light. Angle it. You can have sunrise, sunset, you know, noon, whatever you want to do, right? You can move. So if you wanted to play with lights, so think about lighting. Lighting is a, is hugely powerful, right? So you take a picture, you move the sun. Take a picture, you move the sun. And you just move the sun, and then the shadow moves across your character or your object. So it looks like passing of time. So you're like, you know, if you want to tell a story like somebody's thinking, right? So if you have a pet rock and you draw a little Sharpie face like they're thinking on the pet rock, and then you just don't move the rock, you just move the light, so it looks like the shadow is going from one side to another, and it is like I've been thinking about this rock all day or something, you know. That's right. There's no rules. Break all the rules.
That's the gold tip of the day right there, I think. I think we forget too easily that when we're just trying to tell something, like it's so easy for us to just say, oh, let's just throw some text up that says a day has gone by instead of, I wonder how we could show it.
Yeah.
You know, and
right. So this is a little Lego stand that I made with my little movie director dude. And on the bottom is just a standard train wheels that you get from Lego. I actually stole this from my Winter Village Christmas train. I borrowed it. I'll put it back around December. Anyway, put that on here. Put your camera on. It just sits there, right? And then it rotates and rolls.
Oh, sweet.
So what you do... you have a piece of track and you put your camera on the track. Oh, come on, set up there. There you go. And then what you do is you do your onion skinning, and then you can use a rod or something, but then you kind of eyeball where the, you know, what you call them are the cross members. And then you say, okay, take a picture, move it to the next cross member, take a picture, move it to the next cross member. That way you have a guide, and the guide's right. Built right into the track. Does that make sense?
Yeah, oh, totally. Yeah, so then your movement is consistent from one
thing. Now you can do a pan.
Yeah.
And because you're using a remote shutter, you're never touching the camera.
Nice.
Does that make sense?
Kevin, twice now you've used the phrase onion skinning. And yeah. I got to admit, I don't know what that means.
Sure. So onion skinning is, and I can't share my screen at the moment. Onion skinning is, let me use this example. Here we go. We're going to use these. These are magnets, but they'll demonstrate for us. So, hang on. Let's say That's my picture. I take a picture. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then the next, so I take a picture here, right? And then I move to take the next picture. Well, onion skinning shows me what the previous picture was. So it's like a transparency. So I can see how far I'm moving. Okay. So when you're starting to do things like, nothing moves at a linear speed. There's always animation easing or something. Like if you were to, if I were to drop this, it drops slow and then it picks up speed, right? So it eases out or eases in, excuse me. When we open a drawer, you know, we don't yank it open in one straight linear move. It's kind of easing in and then easing out again, same thing, right? So that ease animation, and you can do that with onion screen because you might want to, so the closer together like this, and then it's easing out the frame. So you see how they're easing out. And the onion skinning helps you see those previous frames. So okay. You can kind of adjust to see how far you moved out. Yeah. Does that make sense? Does that help?
Okay.
Yeah. It should. And then I think what he's trying to say too is that in order to do that effectively, onion skinning is a feature that allows you to overlay all of the cells on top of each other, and the ones that are kind of in, so you see the whole animation one through the next.
Well, yeah, and then but the app that you use, you can set the onion screening to 3 frames, 5 frames,
right?
So you don't see,
you have the whole, to see all of right? them. You can choose which ones you want.
You just see just a little bit before, and you can kind of predict a little bit forward on where it should go based on your set. Some of the more sophisticated software, if you're telling it, I want to do this kind of, if I want to do a quint ease out animation, it will do the algorithm. It'll set the frames for you and do the onion skinning. And then you just follow it that way. Mm. But that's, you know, that's the big, you know, heavy duty software. But then if you want to do something, here's something really cool too. Switch it up, get a curve track. So that whole panning and zooming kind of thing. So if you wanted to do something where you wanted to arc it around one object, so the object's in the center and you arcing around, and then play with light at the same time. Or you can do like something like this. And then if you get about right here, you zoom the camera in. So it kind of wide angle, you're zooming back to wide angle, do the light. And that's one scene. And that might take, I don't know, 60, 70 frames to do something like that. But it's a scene and it's really effective. And you only need, you know, a few Lego and
a little cheap light. You just happen to have some laying around.
And a cheap light and you're done. Any questions? The software. If there's any questions,
oops, I'm just going to show a quick picture of.
Yeah, there's onion skinning. That's a good one. Yeah, that's
okay.
A good
example. Yeah. So you see all of the different cells instead of just one cell at a time. So you can kind of see what it's going to look like as you're developing.
Walk cycles are really hard to do. One walk cycle is 8 frames, and then you can double that to 16 to get smoother. But a four-legged animal or a bug, 6 legs or 4 legs, that walk cycle's even, I mean, it's just, that's just a lot of math. It hurts your head.
So the secret is to have characters with as few legs as possible.
Yeah, they have joints, you just move the leg.
Yeah, like a pet rock would be perfect.
Yeah, right.
Just moving it physically.
Let me see if I can you see those apps?
There you go. Just cleared up for me a little bit there.
If you can see that, there we go. So we've got the one on the I guess it's my right in the corner is stop motion remote. The light blue or the green one, it should be green. It's hard to tell in the camera. The pink one or the purple one is stop motion. That's the actual app itself, the camera. And then there's another version of it. It's a pro version next to that. And then all the way to the end is the Legos version of the stop motion, which is the same thing. It's just makes it, the interface is a little bit more child friendly, you know. And then I use that one probably more than the other one. So let me demonstrate. So on your phone, you've got the same two apps. So on the phone, you've got the same apps. So you have to choose which one's the camera and which one's the remote. So this one is going to be the camera. So I pull up the camera like so. I'm going to start a new frame. Okay, get that reflection out of there. Okay. And then when you see that it's working, right? So my camera. So yep. Hard to tell, but at the bottom, you go ahead and hit that frame to get started. Oh, excuse me. We turn on the camera. So there's your view. So your shutter button, you're zooming. Oh, you got a bunch of other, there's all kinds of different features in here, right? Yep. And then there's a little, right, like a preferences icon. When you press that, you see where it says, it says remote. Well, there it goes. Hi, Siri. No, I don't want to talk to you right now. See where it says remote camera?
Ah, yes.
Okay.
Okay, so I've got to turn on the remote camera here, which is this one. And then when that one comes up, there's the remote camera, and then it tells you what to do. So now, if you see the difference, now you see it come up where it says my iPad. You see that? So now they have to be on the same Wi-Fi network. So let me tap Wi-Fi, and now it's done. I'm gonna let it connect here. Hang on. And you know, I did this about 14 times last night, and once more this morning. Here we go. Make sure. Yeah, there we go. So you can see. Catch up. Come on. You see the camera? Come on already. Wow.
Always when we're live. Dang.
I know, right?
It worked so well in our hours of prep for this.
Okay. I mean, it's there. Let me see. Oh, there we go. Oh, you know what? I got them backwards. This is the camera. So if I show this one, see, this is the camera. And then you see it on here. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So there's I got them backwards. So the iPad should be the other way around. Anyway, it works. Just, mm-hmm.
You just, well, and you've got the option.
Live. You can't be live when you're doing this. Then it works fine. Yeah. Real quick, that's the software. And then there's, if you're doing DSLR cameras, there's Dragon Frame, which is, you know, pretty expensive software. But that's got all the bells and whistles. That's what, you know, the pros use, you know, for that. But you got to, I mean, there's a little bit more. You got to have the right camera. I mean, it's a little bit more intense and obviously more cost because you got to get the right camera. And then some of the tools you need, tape. You ever seen anything flying through the air, like an airplane flying through the, how do you do a stop motion with something flying? Fishing line. It's mm-hmm. transparent. Uh-huh. So you just hang something from a pole or some kind of rig above the camera view, hang something from a fishing line, and then you slide it. So what I do is I'll tie a little bowline line, a bowline knot, hang it on a PVC pipe on two tripod, like two rigs. And then it just hangs. And then I've got tick marks along the PVC pipe. And then you just move the thing on the tick marks, right? The only thing with that is you got to wait till it stops swinging.
Stop swinging, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it could take a while.
And turn off all the fans in your room.
Right. A good pack of construction paper for cutting out trees and, you know, different backgrounds and doing parallax animations, real fun. You can do a lot with construction paper. You can do an intense scene. The intense planning is cutting out, you know, you got to do all the effort to build all your assets from scratch using construction paper. But the end result is really cool. Piece of glass where you just, so if you want to do a reverse, you know, those things where you write on the backside, like a dry erase marker, right? So you set that up and then draw. So it's like a whiteboard animation, but it's on glass, and then you can put different things around it, and it kind of looks, it's pretty, like letters are shown up in the middle of the air kind of thing. But it's with glass, cool. It's tricky with lighting.
I hadn't thought about that. That is very cool.
So Kevin, with that, is the trick to get to set up your lighting so you won't have like basically zero glare off the glass, so you don't see it as glass?
I use a combination of LED, LED fluorescent and incandescent light, because you get different warmths and different temperatures and different shadows with the different kind of lights. So as anybody in video will tell you, lighting is probably the most critical. Second to sound, but we don't have to do sound because we dub in sound after the pack. You don't record while you're doing stuff. Right. So that's one of the benefits of stopping. You don't have to worry about audio. Audio is all after the fact. You dub in, you know, lip syncing, and you dub in voice or sound effects and back. Sound effects are probably the funnest part. cardboard. We did a really cool thing where we did, a cardboard square, and then we made it look like an office, and then we had like a little whiteboard, just another piece of cardboard that looked like a whiteboard, a little desk, some chairs, and then post-production we would animate what was going on the whiteboard, so everything was cardboard. There was no other object except cardboard, but we made all of the scenes look like scenes that we like office environments, and then we would use it kind of looked like paper white cutout is all the animation. So it was kind of a neat effect. What else do I got? Oh, these little things you can get, they're little canvas boards at the hobby store.
Okay.
And then paint your own background. Just paint some really psychedelic backgrounds, or paint a landscape, or paint an office. So you just have your kids paint the background. Okay, I need an office environment. I need a school environment. I need a playground environment. And you just stack these up, and you got, you know, your own backgrounds.
What would you do to I guess put that on the table and keep it from moving? How would you physically set that up? Just tape and
lots of tape, blue tape or masking tape. The Elmer's display board that all your kids have done, right? Watch this.
The old three-panel display. Yeah.
Now you can do a painting on a background here, and now you've got a box, and you can control the lighting and the, you know. And then if you combination things, so if you're doing something like Lego, you put a base plate, you set that up, and then you've got a stage for all your Lego.
Oh, nice.
That moves right across. And then you can do like a mixed media where you color this, or do cut out construction paper and glue them on here, or whatever. You make a scene, and then use Lego as the front piece. You know, so endless, endless, endless opportunities. The only thing, you know, the only thing, I think that's it. That's all I got. Oh wait, hold on, I got some more stuff. Hang on. Magnets. Magnets come in handy when you're trying to get those things where. Let me see this guy here. Hold on. So if you were, let's say this little character, if like a test, if you wanted to practice, how do I get this character to look like he's running, jumps in the air, and does a flip in the air off the table, and then lands back on the and keeps running? So how do you get pictures in the air? How do you get that picture, then that picture, then that picture, then that picture? You know, how do you get that spin in the middle of the air to look at?
I think it takes more than fishing line.
No, it takes, and I don't bring it here, but it takes a, here, I'll use this as a pencil, but you get like heavy gauge, like 8-gauge wire.
Okay.
Like soldering wire. Right. And then you get, and I don't have it here too. I couldn't, I forgot about it. It's called blue sticky or sticky tape or sticky. Mm-hmm. It's like little clay.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it comes in blue strips.
Poster on your wall.
Tough. Yeah. Exactly the same stuff. You get that. You put a dab on the end of your rod. You put your rod on your character. And then the way your camera is you're hiding this. So you set the camera angle to where you don't see that. And then you just spin the rod.
Pay no attention to the rod behind the character. I mean,
that's the fun part. Yeah, right. Pay attention to the rod
character. Blue cast in the UK. That's right.
What's that, Brent?
A blue tack, light bulb Joe in the chat was
that's it.
Telling us the brand name.
Yeah, blue
tack. I think it's the same brand here, Joe.
Clay, those are always claymations. You've heard of that? That's like claymation is probably one of the oldest. That's been around since the 70s. There's some really great YouTube videos out there, claymation, where you can have things like, you know, erupt out of the table, you know.
Takes a lot of patience. I believe that word has come up a few times.
No, you're right. You're not gonna just turn on the camera and, you know, oh, I filmed this scene and I filmed that scene kind of thing. The level of effort to do, I mean, a simple stop motion anime doesn't take no time at all. I mean, it just depends on production, how detailed you went, how many frames you want, how smooth the animation is, those sorts of things. There are some other softwares out there that you can, like if you had a cardboard cutout, then you can go get a set of phenomes, which are all the mouth shapes, phonetic shapes. And then in post-production, you overlay these animated shapes on top of your cardboard cutout, and then you lip sync your narration to those animations, and it looks like your cardboard is talking.
Right. So, one of my favorites, it just popped into my head as soon as you said that, but Tiny Chef on Instagram, I'm betting that they use that because, you know, it's like a little ragdoll stuffy kind of a thing, but the mouth just changes, but it's pretty clear that it's being done in post-production. So.
Yeah. Right. So, I mean, the software, the stop motion, if you get a chance to download, there's the free version. And of course the pro version, I think it's like $4.99 or something. But it comes in, it's kind of like, it's like iMovie is underrated, right? So as a movie editor on your iPhone, stop motion, all of the effects that you can get in there, and you can get the pro version, you can get the add-on phenomes, the phonetic mouthing animation, you can build it right in the app and do all your post-production right there. And it comes with themes and sound effects and background loops and some other background images that you can import in there. So you can do a lot of post-production right in the app. If you don't want to get it out and get into other, your Premiere Pros and your Final Cuts and your After Effects and your Camtasias, all those video editing tools, you can certainly, and when you produce the stop motion that you produce it comes out as a video. Mm. So they just use a video editor to put it in to add additional effects. So if you want to do even the app, they've got like sun glares and different visual effects you do in the software. So
yeah. Very cool. There was a question about software or app ideas for Android users.
Check out stop motion. I believe it's for both.
Okay. Very cool.
It's the most popular sort of app right now. There's a lot of stop motion apps out there. There's iStop Motion, and it's just stop motion. I guess, let me see if I can find it. You can find the link.
It's called Stop Motion Studio.
Yeah.
Okay. Very cool.
It's a real recognizable app. So you want the green one and the purple one.
Oh, I wonder if the one I posted is the green one. Oh, I think that's purple.
Yeah. The one that's got the little Wi-Fi icon on top of the camera.
That's the remote?
That's the remote.
Right.
And then the purple one is the...
Oh, there it is. Remote camera app. Yeah. Okay.
Cool. You don't need a remote if you don't have two devices.
Right.
The only thing is just to make sure your camera and your tripod, there's no wobbling. There's no, you know, it's real secure, because even the tap on the phone could just slightly move that lens mm-hmm. just enough to have a flicker. The other, and I fail at this all the time. So if, let me bring it back down. So let's say I'm in a groove, right? I'm in a rhythm, and I take a picture, move my character, take a picture, move my character, see this, you get in a rhythm because you're kind of doing this, but you see the shadow of my hand over here,
right?
Like flickering. You can see the shadow underneath my hand. So sometimes you're going too fast, right? Especially if you're using a shutter. And so if I'm using two hands, so if I'm shuttering, moving, shuttering like this, and I'm in a rhythm, sometimes I don't get my hand out fast enough. Right. So you see these flickers of shadow coming in the background. So it's one of those things just to kind of look back at your production value and say, where can I improve my lighting? Where can I improve my production, my workflows, all that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Very cool. Very, very cool. Well, it sounds like some folks are already doing the App Store search, getting ready awesome. To give this all a whirl. So,
yeah, everybody needs to take their new app and do a stop motion where put your idiotic cup in your favorite location and do a 360 rotation, right? And then everybody share and tag idiotic with their rotating stop motion cup.
Very cool.
That's there your you homework go. For the day.
That's the assignment for the day. Yeah. And as we approach our time to go song starting moment, we should probably also tell everybody that you've got a whole month to do this little homework
yes.
project, because we take August off.
We do.
Twitter in a way. Twitter does not take a day off.
It does not. So when you've done your assignment for this episode of Sip and Snap, by the way, everybody okay with that? We couldn't call it Drink and Draw because we weren't really drawing or talking about drawing, so we tried to stay with the same theme that we use for Kevin's appearances, and went with Sip and Snap this time. So it's all good.
Eventually we'll have an episode with Kevin called Rock and Roll.
There we go.
What are we going to do there? Play guitar together?
We've got August to figure it out. Awesome. Kevin, this has been so much fun.
Thank you.
Been very cool, as always, to see the comments as folks are kind of jiving into it and doing their own digging in and throwing in links and stuff. Yeah, we will post up a bit of a summary blog on the Domino blog post. And I think, Brent, you were suggesting you'd have a fair number of these links, etc. for folks, if you want to, and so watch the Twitters for when we get that posted up either today or tomorrow, and watch that. Check out the shopping list that we've just built for you. Everybody head off to your favorite gizmos.
I hope I was able to share a few things.
Yeah, sorry. If you've got any examples, Kevin, that you can share, some links of some of those, some of the things you've talked about, some of the work you've done, that would be super cool. Or if you just find a cool version of it, that would be awesome to see as well. If you want to throw those up on Twitter, we can share those in the blog.
Very cool.
I was working on one to promo this actual session, but I ran out of time.
That's always the case.
It's all good. So thanks again, Kevin.
Awesome, guys. Thanks so much.
Awesome. Thanks, everybody, for joining us.
See everybody in September.
Have a great summer.